Number three, the people of the state of New York versus John Wakefield. We'll give council a few minutes to collect themselves and get organized. Good afternoon, council.
Good afternoon, your honors. Matthew Hug for John Wakefield, the appellant in this matter. Your honors, may I reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal?
You may, sir.
Your honors, on two counts, the two main counts in this appeal relate to the abuse of discretion of the trial court in its Frye determination, as well as the confrontation issue that were raised in point two. I'm happy to answer questions with respect to either one. I don't know which is more to the court's liking, but I think both of them present very interesting issues for this court's consideration, and they leapfrog from your decisions in the Williams and Foster Bay matter, and now you have one where a Frye hearing was conducted, but without the source code. And I think that even if
counsel, if I can interrupt you, I'm on the screen. Hello, good afternoon. Why don't you address, if you would, at this point, why the defendant was entitled to the source code when they've gotten everything else? Why do they need that to be able to proceed?
Well, there's a two-part answer to that, Your Honor. First, the defendant was entitled to the source code both at the Frye hearing as well as prior to trial so that he could have an independent expert examine exactly what the declarant was going to be saying. Secondly, the refusal by the progenitor of this software to release the software to the greater scientific community stands as an impediment to him establishing that it is also accepted by the greater scientific community. I think it's a truism to say that if the greater scientific community hasn't had a chance to look at a process, they can't be deemed to have accepted it.
Well, it sounds like that's independent of the defendant's right to have it. That is, the defendant may have no right, but you're still making an argument based on Frye that some measure of the scientific community has access.
That's precisely right, Judge. I don't think that we need to limit it to, was the defendant entitled to it? I think he was, because who else was going to cross-examine the declarant here? It wasn't going to be the prosecution. They showed no desire to investigate what they paid for. They paid for an answer, and they received it.
Counsel, is it for lawyers and judges to say what the scientific community must have access to or should have access to in order to approve of the methodology in question? Because there are studies out there on this very, on the true allele system that look upon it favorably. So no, it doesn't seem as if the community as a whole is complaining about lack of access to source code.
Well, first we got to look at what was the state of the science in 2014. Not what the state of the science may be today. If we looked at it today, we would know that New York State Police abandoned True Allele after a cheating scandal because they couldn't get their own officers to even figure out what buttons to push. But to address your question in the main, it is the job of lawyers and judges, as the only profession in this state that takes an oath to the Constitution and is entrusted with ensuring that what happens in our courtrooms is fair. And yes, we do have the authority to say before we allow something to come into one of those courtrooms, it's going to have general acceptance.
But counsel, to go back then to your original point, which is our standard of review is an abuse of discretion. So I think your point about acceptance in the scientific community and needing the code, that seems to me to fall within the heartland of the discretion of the trial judge. Now, we can say is it an abuse or not, but that's the standard we would be looking at. Your other arguments, your confrontation clause argument and the obligation to disclose it, that seems somewhat different, right?
Yes.
So what would the standard be for that? I mean, we would have to decide whether under the Constitution your client's entitled to this, right?
Well, first, I think the appellate division appropriately reversed the lower court by finding that the True Allele program and its report was testimonial. So then the second question becomes, well, who is the declarant?
But is there some confusion there over whether it's the report or the code? Because certainly the report, yes, but the code isn't the report.
Well, we don't know what the code is.
It's an algorithm. Let's assume that.
Well, that's what he says it is. See, this is the conundrum here.
So what would you say it is?
The declarant is akin to the analyst. So if an analyst, according to this court's holdings in a string of DNA cases, the declarant must be the person that actually did the analysis. In this case, Dr. Perlin did not do the analysis. His computer.
But he created the program.
Well, right. He created the program. So he testified that he wrote the code. But much like Geppetto created Pinocchio, at some point the horse is out of the barn. Does Dr. Perlin know what internal biases he had when he wrote that code? Is he an infallible code writer?
Couldn't you cross-examine Dr. Perlin on that? Excuse me, I'm sorry.
No, it would have been severely hamstrung because what are you going to cross-examine him on? He can say anything.
Well, it seems easier to cross-examine Dr. Perlin than it would be to pages and pages of code.
Right, so it's a practical problem. It's not a constitutional problem. You've hit the nail on the head, Your Honor, because and what the appellate division did and I think what the prosecution is trying to do is to take a practical problem, make it into a legal problem. Practically, what could have happened, which is what counsel wanted to do, as he explained in his memorandum of law when he sought this information, was cross-examination of Dr. Perlin cannot be conducted without access to what his machine actually does, what code was written in there by him or his partner. So, yes, practically speaking, he
so
would still be the vessel.
So are you essentially arguing that you're stuck with, because he said so, because you don't have the actual code?
To a degree.
To validity.
To a degree, and I think that's what Judge Pritzker was getting at when he wrote the decision to say that we are in like this brave new world here where we have a combination of machine and human, and the only practical means that we can do right now is to question Dr. Perlin armed with his source code, maybe after...
Wait, counsel, if I can interrupt you, then why isn't that... I don't understand why you're saying that's not a constitutional issue. Isn't the point... I thought the point you were making was without the source code, you cannot have an effective cross-examination. You don't have the information that you need to ask the questions.
That's exactly what I'm saying, Judge. And what I'm saying is that the prosecution and the court made a practical problem, a practical question of, well, who are you going to, you can't question the computer. I understand you can't question the computer, but you can question the person that's in front of you with the computer's.
I understand. All I'm saying is that what you continue to say is the practical problem, because there's a computer, it's not a human being, they're not going to be responding. Nevertheless, that it devolves to a constitutional issue. When we think of it in legal terms, it's a constitutional issue that you're arguing, is it not?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Counselor, yes. What are you arguing under the Confrontation Clause? That the codes are the declarant, or that the code should have been used to assist in cross-examination?
Well, that's for the court to decide. I would argue first and foremost that the code itself is the declarant. And that
but the code doesn't analyze the data, right? I mean, the code, a human has to put in the data, set the parameters, run the calculations, interpret the results. There's several steps between computer and result. Would
I disagree,
agree?
Your Honor. I think that the testimony from Dr. Perlin said it all. He's testified that my system is an expert system. It, quote, proposes possibilities. It, quote, thinks. It, quote, hypothesizes. It, quote, draws inferences. It, quote, solves the problem. And then asks, what does the analyst do? And he says that the analyst asks TA, true allele, to solve everything, presses a button, and it solves everything. The analyst does nothing. The analyst in this case, if it had been the state police, who couldn't do it. Remember, the district attorney hired Dr. Perlin personally because the state police couldn't figure out after 5 years how to press these buttons. So Dr. Perlin's computer solves everything. He testified to it himself. He calls
so
it.
So why is it sufficient just to cross-examine Dr. Perlin, who created the program?
Because Dr. Perlin didn't do the analysis of the DNA result. The computer did, based upon biases or whatever else was written in that 170,000 lines of code. That is the crux of the issue, is that Dr. Perlin is not the declarant by himself. He is the declarant with his creation. And without having both together, you can't...
So, counsel, can I just confirm, although at the time, since you're saying we look at the science at the time, although at the time, Dr. Perlin was unwilling to turn over the source code based on his proprietary claim, He has indicated since then that he would or has. Is that not correct?
I mean, it's outside the record. I don't know what he's currently claiming as, you know, as a business practice, but I don't.
I thought there were cases to that effect. I'm not asking for statements that otherwise would not be in the public domain.
Assuming that he is, it's of no moment for this case, because if this court finds that it was an abuse of discretion to admit this evidence, that evidence is excised, and without that evidence, this must be reversed and dismissed.
That's what I wanted to turn you to, actually, is harmless error again. So focusing just on the true allele evidence, if we side with you there.
Yes.
Seems to me there's still an awful lot of other evidence inculpating Mr. Wakefield. Mm. You want to address why this is not harmless?
I would like to, yes. First, I don't think you get the harmless error analysis at all because there's not overwhelming evidence of guilt. Until you get to overwhelming evidence of guilt, you don't touch harmless error. Assuming that you do find overwhelming evidence, I would push back on that and say the prosecution paid a king's ransom to get this evidence in. They wouldn't have done so if they thought that they didn't need it. Number two, you have jailhouse informants as the primary testimony here after being promised, you know, immediate releases. These people are being shown photographs, single photographs of the defendant, and then shown photo arrays. You've got a drug addict that takes a reward.
But counsel, wasn't there also other DNA evidence, not the one that went through the true allele process, or have I misunderstood the record, that other evidence connects him to the crime?
Other DNA evidence run through the stochastic method by the New York State Police Forensic Investigation Center? There was a witness that testified, but no, those results are so meaningless. It's like one of them was like 1 in 400 chance. I mean, these likelihood ratios were far too low. So no, there is no direct evidence, Your Honor, of the defendant's guilt. There was no eyewitnesses. There's no confession. There's no admission. There is nothing tying him to this except for a series of ne'er-do-wells in the county that were more than willing to abide by offers made by the district attorney's office to get them to testify.
Thank you, counsel. Counsel?
Good afternoon, Your Honor. Thank you very much. Peter Willis for the Schenectady County District Attorney's Office. I've been listening, obviously, to the arguments in the original case and Mr. Hugg here today. I want to push back on the phrase that is being used, the black box here. That could not be further from the truth as respect to at least true allele. The record of the Fry hearing contains 7 different validation studies, other studies that are performed.
Does it matter that 6 of the 7 Dr. Perlin was involved in and the 7th he was an advisor?
I don't believe he was an advisor, but Your Honor, I don't think it matters in terms of invalidating those studies. They're performed in conjunction with other forensic laboratories in the state. To suggest that Dr. Perlin, because he works.
But counsel, isn't the point that they're not then in that sense fully independent, right? That there is at least one individual who clearly has a conflict.
I agree, but for the record, that there are 2 studies provided by Jay Caponera working at the New York State Police Forensic Investigation Center who testified, I did these studies completely independent of Dr. Perlin. Also submitted into the record at the hearing was a study performed by the Forensic Science Division in the state of Virginia, who also performed
Does
validation.
Does it matter that they had purchased the program and had arguably an interest in it being deemed valid?
Whether they had I think that the way they're going to have to do it is if they're going to try to use this system in general to adopt as their course, as their casework system, whether they paid for it or not, I don't think informs their decision whether they're going to essentially rig their data.
So your argument is it doesn't matter that you may have an interest in it being validated as long as there is evidence of validation?
I think if there is evidence of validation, absolutely. I think that if you want to suggest that the forensic scientists who are using this system are somehow unethically creating validation studies, I wouldn't.
No, it's not a question of unethically. Wouldn't it be better when you're talking about science? Often people don't realize they have biases. Science is supposed to be different. And having someone who was involved in making it, it does cause questions or concerns, especially when you're talking about somebody's liberty.
Right. Well, that's why the studies from Virginia and Jay Caponera are specifically valuable to deciding this issue.
So
they were not paid for these studies. They were engaging in these studies in order to obtain certification to be able to use this program in casework. That's what Jay Caponera testified to, that these were the type of studies you would use to become certified to allow the output to be used in connection with the FBI laboratory, with CODIS, and to obtain national certification.
So validation seems a little off topic. It seems more like a Daubert issue than a Fry issue. And some of the people's own exhibits, 25 and 26 in particular, I think, say things like implementation of this has lagged, it's unfamiliar to many DNA scientists. So validation is not irrelevant, but it seems to me your burden is to show general acceptance in the scientific community.
I would agree, Your Honor. And I think the Frye hearing did that. There has to be a first. That's what the Wesley case taught us about DNA. One of the only Cellmark, the only real lab in the country back in the 80s who was doing that DNA work, performed the analysis in that case, brought it in front of this court, and it was approved of. It's sort of the same thing here.
General acceptance in the scientific community doesn't involve people outside of the process doing the testing of it to make that determination.
I'm not sure I follow Your Honor's question.
Are you saying that the scientific community can, in fact, include Perlin and others who bought the program?
Can it include those members of the community?
Those are the community that made the decisions here.
Well, I would agree they're part of the scientific community, but that wasn't the only community that we presented evidence of. As Justice Wilson just referenced, those articles written about Trulio are uniformly positive in their remarks on how the system analyzes DNA evidence. The leading creators of other competing DNA analysis programs.
There is no question that they were positive. The concern is who was involved in those studies.
I agree. But just because cybergenetics is involved in a study does not invalidate the study.
Isn't a core principle in science that you don't have those who might have a conflict? This is not about ethics, but those who might have a particular conflict or who have a proprietary interest should not be part of the process that's assessing and evaluating the system or the methodology or the program or the algorithm or whatever it is. I mean, it's a core principle of science.
I would disagree with that, Your Honor. I don't believe that's backed up, one, by this court's decision in Wesley, again, where the studies concerning DNA analysis were performed by the very same laboratory that ended up analyzing the DNA evidence in that case. But also, in general, a pioneering scientific process is most naturally going to be worked upon and validated by those people that are most closely assembled with it. But that's also the reason why the DNA subcommittee for New York State spent 3 years assessing these presentations from Trulio in connection with the New York State Police Forensic Investigation Center to determine whether or not this was an appropriate type of analysis to be used in New York State.
Counsel, can you address, go through the harmlessness analysis, please?
Yes, Your Honor. So in this case, in addition to the true allele evidence, which even if you move that aside, there was testimony from Andrea Lester from the New York State Police Forensic Investigation Center, the original analyst on the case. She connected the DNA on a scrape from the victim's forearm, as well as a mixed sample from the rear of his shirt collar. And remember, this is a victim who was found strangled to death with a guitar cord that was ostensibly wrapped around his neck by the person who was killing him from behind. So the evidence of the defendant's DNA on the rear of his shirt collar was particularly incriminating. That was combined with the fact that the defendant admitted the murder to three different people, one of whom, the record shows, Robert Evans, testified to an interaction that could have only happened in about a three-day span when the defendant had been released from the local jail. He was out for about 3 days during which time the defendant was, the victim was killed. His, Mr. Wakefield's DNA also shows up on bottles in the victim's apartment from a party that occurred during that three-day period, and Robert Evans encounters him a couple blocks away from the residence where he admits the murder, says he wants to go back to the scene to steal more of his items. That is particularly powerful and incriminating evidence, in it aside from the other DNA evidence. Additionally, the defendant's seen on the street trying to sell electronics that match up with the items that are taken from the victim's house, as well as holding a bag that was, according to the witness, testified was the same one that the victim is shown in a picture with from a family trip from several years prior. So even if the Truill evidence is excised from the case, which I submit it ought not to be under any circumstance, the evidence here of guilt is still overwhelming in this instance. I'd also submit that the defendant's argument that he's raising here, that the source code ought to have been released as part of a Fry hearing, was not made to the trial court. The trial court was never asked about that issue. It was never said, there was no testimony at the Fry hearing from anyone that said source code review is part of the scientific community's review of new and emerging DNA technology. In fact, and I know it comes after the Fry hearing, we quote the International Society of Forensic Geneticists, who say source code review is not meaningful in a Fry context. And that's an international organization made up of forensic geneticists, including members of the National Institute of Standards at the time. I would submit that there is, the record in this case is clear, Truill more than passed the Fry standard in this case, regardless of whether or not Dr. Perlin was involved in some of the studies.
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you very much.
Counsel, your rebuttal?
Yes, just to put a fine point on preservation, of course, counsel's arguments lack merit with respect to preservation. I'd point to appellate appendix 277 through 295, where there's lengthy questioning of Perlin about black box technology and whether or not it can be ever accepted. I would point out at record page 489 in defendant's memorandum of law following the hearing, the entire point of his argument was that there can be no acceptance generally in the scientific community when the source code is being hidden from view. I would push back on the harmless error situation that counsel brings up. When you cannot unhear one gazillion and one chance that it's the defendant and no one else. Perlin's testimony, if it shouldn't have been heard, cannot be deemed harmless because the numbers are so cartoonishly huge that Andrea Lester's testimony would have drowned in it. With respect to the Fry hearing, and the validation studies, I think your honors are exactly right. There is deep concern and should be that the person that is peddling the technology and making a substantial fortune from it should not be the one that we entrusted to decide whether it works. You don't need to look any further than the news earlier this year with Elizabeth Holmes and Theranos. She pulled such a scheme where she told everyone that her product worked. One drop of blood, another miracle product. One drop of blood will tell you if you have any genetic defect such that you could get immediate medical attention. Now, she was able to pass her validation studies off on sophisticated venture capitalists and make billions of dollars only to have it all collapse because when somebody did get a look at what she was doing, it was a smoke and mirrors. And this is the concern. I am not saying that Dr. Perlin is a bad actor. I'm saying that we don't know if he is, and as a result, Mr. Wakefield should not be wondering if he is
counsel,
as he serves life in prison.
Isn't the point of Judge Kaye's concurrence in Wesley about this type of issue that you need to be cautious here? And to me, again, that goes to the heartland of why we have a hearing. Trial judge hears this. Trial judge is well aware of these potential influences on the testimony of these various experts, either because they bought the software or because they had some involvement in developing the software. And why isn't that entrusted, the decision of how much weight, how cautious we should be in assessing those studies, why isn't that entrusted to the trial judge under an abuse of discretion standard?
Well, because that's why we have review now, Your Honor, because
under an abuse of discretion standard.
Right. I don't see how it cannot be an abuse of discretion to say that something exists when we don't get to look to
but
see.
But I think what you're saying, though, is because of these, the interest, and they're varied and different here, that as a matter of law makes this an abuse of discretion.
I would agree with that proposition, Judge.
Thank you, counsel.